And at your retreat, I heard that there was some anxieties expressed over the recent HLC report that kind of flagged us in some important critical areas. So I wanted to give you an update. I didn't feel like I could try to get it wormed in onto the agenda because I actually didn't have the report, the numbers done until today for last semester. So I just wanted to share them and make myself available for any kind of questions you might have. I know that is not, may I approach the benches? Well, there's an officer in hand. Oops, can't do that. So I'll make myself available just as a quick summary of what I'm presenting to you. We do an assessment each semester. Full-time faculty are reporting assessment results in Canvas, and then I have to compile it all up and crank out this report. So it's just informational. I could walk through it if you'd like at some point, but I think you'll be able to understand it on your own. We are in the beginnings of this program, but we're doing okay from my perspective. The very bottom of the table, you can kind of see some percentages. We had roughly 73% of our full-time faculty reporting this last round, so this would have been winter 21 data. I'm sure it's more than that, but we're still working out our process. I know there are faculty that reported that I didn't get the data for, so I just haven't been able to figure out what's going on with that. But it'll be higher than that. We've got roughly 42% of our student body reported on in this last semester, which I think is great at this stage. We certainly want more, but we haven't even opened up to the adjunct faculty yet. Our plan is to possibly bring them in this next semester, so we'll have an even greater number canvassed in that following semester. So that's my report. Thank you for receiving, and as I said, I'll be here later if you want to ask me anything about it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else wish to address the board?
Evening. My name is Brent Forsman. I am a full-time faculty member here at Political Science. I'm also the department chair for the Social Science Division, and I'm participating closely with the HLC report. I'm part of the ARC, the Academic Review Committee, and I volunteered and was part of the subcommittee that is working on addressing the, those concerns from HLC. I first want to state that when you read that HLC report, we met every requirement. Now, three or four requirements had a concern, and we are addressing those concerns. But we met every requirement, and so we shouldn't be in a panic. We should be addressing those issues, and we are. And the ARC and the assessment committee that Bill Gibbons is part of are addressing that. Part of my work as part of that committee, I joined the subcommittee, and I volunteered to be part of the working group that dealt with one of those concerns. One of those concerns was that the HLC did not see global awareness in any of our competencies. So they did not know if we were pursuing that. That was kind of new, it was kind of a surprise. It took everybody by surprise that that was a criteria. But we addressed it. And my working group actually has reformulated our civic responsibility general education requirement to include outcomes that include global awareness and DEI. Part of my working group was our director of DEI, Jessica Brown. She was part of that, so we have a good working group now. What we reformulated has been sent to the faculty for some feedback, and then ARC will vote on that and then make that part of our criteria for general education. So I think we're making some progress. There are lots of other areas that we need to work on, those two or three other areas, particularly in assessment. But I want to portray to you that we are making progress and that we're trying to work collaboratively together, and that we're going to get this done and be better for it in the end. So if you have any questions, feel free to ask me afterwards, and thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else wish to address the board?
Hello, Bob Hunkler, geography professor. I wanted to give kudos to the board and also to faculty for their DEI efforts. Diversity, equity, and inclusion. When you get any number of human beings together, you know that there's going to be some exclusion. It's just something in our makeup. We tend to do that. And if we're not reminding ourselves daily not to do that, it's chaos. So we have to, I think it's very good that we're doing that. I want to mention the presentation that was given on Friday, December 3rd. If you did not catch that presentation from Dr. Okunlami, Dr. O, on disability, it was fantastic. I'm going to turn a little bit here because I want to say that it's online. That video is online, sc4.edu/DEI, and just click on events and scroll down and you'll see it. 1 hour long, fantastic. My students were there, rave reviews. He was just so informative and so positive. I think Pete was there too, and I heard you asking some questions there at the end about the basketball. That would be so cool. So the things that the board is doing trickles down, and I know that we're at a pivotal point here in history. We're going to look back on 2020, 2021 as the DEI revolution. There's not a single employee at the college today that will retire after this is done. And the DEI is going to continue, and we're on board. And whoever the next chair is, I encourage you to bring it up at every meeting from the board. That really is important, so thank you for doing that so far. I see great things coming, and we just got to keep it day by day. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to address the board? Michael Forth, community member. Once again, the board has chosen to ignore the fact that St. Clair County has a raging pandemic, that the current community spread level is red. They choose to ignore the recommendations of health professionals to conduct virtual meetings, since the chief academic officer is doing 99% of her job remotely from Florida. Why does the board find it necessary to meet in person? They see that we're a little scrunched in more than we normally would have been. I wanted to take a moment to point out also that the following community college increased their enrollment numbers this year: Muskegon Community, Kellogg Community, Monroe County Community, Glen Oaks Community College, Kalamazoo, and Grand Rapids Community College. They were top performers due to a variety of reasons, but a couple of reasons stand out. First, they recruited touting the benefits of two programs: the Futures of Frontliners program, the Futures for Frontliners program, which is providing tuition to people working in crucial frontline positions during the pandemic, and the Michigan Reconnect program, which is a scholarship program that pays for you to attend your in-district community college tuition-free. It also provides one-time grants for Michiganders to enroll in an approved training program with the Skills Scholarship. The community would like to know how many students here are taking advantage of these programs. The second thing that these colleges did is provide programs related to the skilled trades so that students can become welders and plumbers and construction workers. Since enrollment is down here, as trustees, are you planning on wanting to see a plan for increased enrollment? Lastly, if any of you are planning to resign, those of you who are not up for re-election, please do it before the deadline to get the seat on the ballot next November. That way the community can decide who sits on this board and not the board itself. Thanks.
Good afternoon, Janice Fritz, I'm a biology professor. This evening you get a second reading of a potential change to the non-discrimination statement in the board policies. I just want to take a moment to say that I'm really glad to see that our Glow Club and the Young Office Board, and to urge you to please vote in favor of that change. I think it's important that all members of our community see that we're making it explicit that we're going to be accepting of various groups. I think it's important that we add in veteran status, that we add in gender expression and gender identity. And also important is making sure that groups are referred to by the terms that they prefer to be referred to, which is the main reason to change from handicapped to disabled. That's disability is the term that's used now rather than handicapped by most of the individuals in that community, which is an important piece I'm finding of DEI and was mentioned at Bob talked about from last week, that you need to talk to individuals in these categories and find out from them what they prefer, as opposed to just deciding what works for us. So I think that these proposed changes are really good, and I hope that you vote in favor. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to address the board?
Hello, Carrie Dollar, professor of biology. I just wanted to come today and say thank you for our wonderful support staff that we have here at the college, especially our lab techs. So I work in the STEM division, and Karen Rodenbuff is our STEM lab technician, and she is awesome. And I've written letters to some administrators here at the college to just let them know what a blessing she is to the STEM division. And we would not be able to function at the level that we do without her assistance. And I'm sure there are several other unsung heroes here at the college that just don't get the recognition that they deserve. And I know right now that there are staffing issues, and it's not just SC4, it's everywhere. People are leaving various places, and I want to make sure that we're doing everything we can to retain these wonderful individuals that we have. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to address the board?
Seeing none, hearing none, we move forward. In your packet are the minutes of the regular meeting of House Member 11 and the retreat held on the 12th. Is there a motion to approve the minutes as presented?
So moved.
For support.
Support.
Support and discussion. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, motion carries.
Mr. Chair, just to point out, choose to be abstained because I wasn't here. So I just want to make that known for Sarah for the notes that they'll abstain on the minutes.
So noted.
Thank you.
Financial reports are also included in your packet, and the treasurer is present. Kurt, do you have any updates?
Financials are tracking the way we had anticipated. Nothing extraordinary to report. However, I would start to mention a cautionary note. Finances this year are appearing and may end up being a little tighter than last year. That seems counterintuitive in some ways with the pandemic significant change in operations last year. However, last year we were able to reduce some expenditures, simply as example as utilities, and leaving more positions vacant and not conducting all activities, so we were able to adjust during that pandemic, significant pandemic impact. And this year seems to be shaping up a little tighter as we start up more operations, but we don't have all the in-person revenue to support that. So actually, this pandemic may have an impact for our finances that lags a little bit. So I just wanted to bring that as a cautionary item. A couple of other examples. For example, we have a fixed cost, if you will, of full-time faculty teaching online versus prior time teaching perhaps a mix or primarily in person. And seat number for online is less than the in-person seat number in a class. So we have the same cost for full-time faculty teaching fewer seats. So instead of teaching, for example, 120 students, might be teaching 95 students. It's contractual. That's, you know, we're following a contract. Just wanted to point out that you have the same cost but less revenue. There's other examples. Athletics is functioning, but we have fewer fans and limited concessions. And concerts are starting. Plays are starting, but we have fewer people attending and paying. General revenue support isn't there to necessarily match the ramp up of activities. More reporting is required, which is bringing more pressure on our positions. State, federal, financial aid, Reconnect program is a very labor-intense program to administer. Very valuable program to participate, but it is labor-intensive to administer. So I just wanted to mention, it's simply causing an increased concern and caution as we progress throughout the year. Of course, we will monitor it and give you updates.
Any questions on the financial statements for this period of time?
Kurt, part of the page, it's not numbered, it's at the top, it says part A. So
payments are up $300,000. Looks like state aid is up $300,000, so it's almost like a $600,000-$700,000 revenue increase. So I guess I appreciate the explanation, but it looks to me like tuition is up.
It is, and the delta between year-to-date revenue and expenditure is about the same or a little bit better than last year, but the percentage is worse. And so I'm just bringing up a caution that it just seems to be tightening. As we look at the trend, as we look at what will happen in the future, not so much looking at where we are today, I'm looking at where it may be going and just raising a caution flag that we need to be very diligent as we go through this year. But you're correct as far as the statement as of today. I'm just looking more forward.
Kirk, are there any recommendations being formulated to address this issue, or is this just a monitoring right now?
At this point, it's a monitoring. We don't have anything that we would be changing it as far as today. It's just a caution, just a monitoring. Just wanted to make sure everyone's aware that we are looking.
Also, interesting line on page 21, part G. There's a budget for student enrollment marketing initiative. And I was just curious about that. That sounds intriguing, and we are all rightly concerned about enrollments. Can you explain that a little bit? What's that all about?
Yes, thank you for asking. That is intriguing. We worked with our admissions department. We identified an initiative to reach students that had either applied, perhaps even started the registration process, but never completed. So there's a firm, it's called Motomatics, that other colleges have used, and they reach out through social media directly to these individuals to encourage those individuals to complete the process. Hey, you've started at SC4, don't forget to finish, or what can we do to help you finish? We only pay for the students that convert to a registered student. So we give this firm a list of potential students that may want, that they just haven't finished registration, and they try to convert them to registrations. We only pay them if they register. And so that expense is that additional enrollment that we're generating through that. So that through the Student Services Office.
Was this initiated in fall?
Yes, this expense was for fall because we only paid for those that converted. So this expense was for fall. We will try that again for winter. And yes, it looked like it was a very successful program.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you, Kirk. Communications and petitions are also included in the electronic file.
Yes, and I wonder if I can add something.
Yes.
Hey, can you tell us how many students we have in the Futures for Frontliners and the other program? Because it's pretty substantial. I think everyone here needs to know.
Futures for Frontliners and Reconnect. Approximately 800 students are enrolled for fall semester. Obviously, we don't have winter yet. I will say the number that were qualified that chose not to come is about half as many. So, I mean, there was like another 800 that could have enrolled and chose not to at this point. So, we work with those students every day and trying to help them enroll and reach the finish line. So, I can get the board exact numbers, but those are ballpark figures.
Gifts. Thank you, Steiner.
$250 from City of Bangor, the same for the Challenger Learning Center, $250 from Patty Smith for the Challenger Learning Center, $250 from Teresa Hill for the Challenger Learning Center, and $1,000 from Michael McNeil for the Challenger Learning Center.
Is there a motion to accept these gifts as presented?
So moved.
So moved. For support?
Support.
Support. Any discussion?
Yes. I see we've got $750 or $1,000. I appreciate everyone that donated for whatever, but specifically the Challenger Learning Center. Can someone tell me to date how much we've raised for the Challenger Learning Center?
Sure. With checks that we know are coming, we are over $100,000 that we have raised for the Challenger Learning Center. That's about 74, almost 75 different donors that have donated, which is of interest in that these are mostly 75 donors that have not donated to the college in any way before. So these are new donors. So it's exciting to have that opportunity to connect with people.
Great.
And we will continue to fundraise for this, as many of these dollars are to support trips to the Challenger Center. Continue to fundraise throughout the Challenger Center.
Motion on the floor for support. All those in favor say aye. 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 Opposed? Under old business, the edits of the governance manual, second reading. Starts on page 47. So, what's in the red is what is being proposed to add to the governance manual. And I don't see anything cross out, so this is a an addition to the governance manual. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. So, this section would be under board planning and agenda, the board of various responsibilities, governance, et cetera, and the agenda for the board, director, chair, consultation, president, blah, blah, blah. Agenda will be delivered to the board at least 7 days before the meeting. And then the addition is a preliminary agenda and accompanying materials will be sent 7 days before the working scheduled meeting or retreat. Based on trustee input, a final agenda and accompanying materials will be delivered to trustees by noon on the Tuesday before the regularly scheduled meeting or retreat. Do we have a conflict with the first paragraph? The agenda will be delivered to the board at least 7 days before the meeting.
Mr. Chair, never having done an edit for this particular audience or this particular document before, I can see the second sentence under number one that could be struck if the board finds favor with the paragraph in red that follows that, because it is there's some confusion with those two things as they're presented back to back.
All right.
So I understand that.
Well, there's a couple things. One, we can't change it in the second reading.
Oh, well, that's news to me, but I understand.
So, likewise, we had the first reading, we couldn't change anything.
So, if there were to be an edit, what would happen then? Or has that
it would go
been
back to a
transpire,
to
a first reading of something
but
differently?
At the retreat, and I know you weren't there, but you may have heard some feedback. At the retreat, when we talked about this, we just help me here, Sarah. We actually now send out the preliminary
agenda 14 days.
14 days prior to.
Yes.
And then the final agenda subsequent to additions, deletions goes out
7 days. And the accompanying materials, 7 days.
7 days.
So 14
right.
Fred, you gotta help me out here, because at the retreat, I asked that, for John's sake, since he wasn't there, that this stays in exactly as it is. But I thought that there were two issues. One was the setting of the agenda, and we talked about, we do it what just Sarah just said, so that kind of covered that. And then the second part was, Fred, you had drawn up, you know, January through December of possibly some things, and then that's where I was enlightened, because our fiscal year doesn't really start in January, it starts in July. So I left the meeting kind of thinking that even though I wanted this on here because the committee had worked on it, but it was almost like we were going to vote no because we kind of got it settled at the retreat, but I'm not sure. That's why I got to defer to you, especially on the second portion of January through December, if you wanted to proceed with that or you were satisfied with the general discussion at the retreat before I vote on this.
Well, at the retreat, I said, believe me, I like an agenda for the whole year that has things in it. Some are prepared by law that relate to the budget or resolutions or whatever. But it's a good idea to have these things listed in 1 month wherever it's relevant. And Randy brings up this point. Our year actually begins July 1. But having said that, I don't think there was any disagreement about the concept of having an agenda for the year, and if we know that there are certain things that should be discussed in a particular month, we will write that up right at the beginning of the year. So we know that in March certain things are going to be covered, in February, June, July, whatever. So no one, I don't believe anybody was against that. It was, my issue was, I didn't think of long in governance manual to list all those individual specific points. I think what's in the manual should indicate that we do want to have a meeting where we set priorities, where we set goals, where we evaluate the president, and plug those into a calendar. But those kind of those details are relevant to today's board, may not be relevant to boards, you know, somewhere downstream. That's why when you read through a lot of the manual and even our bylaws, they're not that specific. They sort of say you need a plan and you need a planning session, but there's no details in there on what's to be covered in the planning session. It's just a broad statement. And that's the way I interpret this particular section. Yes, we should have priorities, and yes, we should plan, and yes, we should have we have to deal with.
Two things, if I may. The questions about the agenda and the accompanying materials, part of what the committee felt was we still don't know, we being that subcommittee, how things get on the agenda in that regard. And so this was kind of forcing the issue. We thought that, okay, we get a preliminary one, then we'll see if Karen's idea on the agenda she had, if that's there, or John's idea about that is there, then we can ask for input on that for the final agenda. And that was the concept behind preliminary first, let's take a look at it, ask again if we needed to, or be prepared to make a motion when we have the meeting or the retreat and vote on it. So that was the concept behind that. Again, as someone who's used to drafting and redrafting and rewriting, I have no problem addressing the concerns. I am a little chagrined that these concerns didn't come prior to it, but I'm not going to belabor that particular point. Again, emails and conversations are always good to have in order to get what you're articulating right now, and perhaps we can prepare drafts prior to. Addressing the other point, Mr. Chair, if I may, if I look at number three, it does say on page 48, quarterly retreat sessions, annual planning session, priorities, goals. And that's where Fred's good work, I thought, came in, because that calendar that follows addresses the planning sessions, the priorities, and lays out the following year. That's the last sentence on number three, which is not being touched. And then we have the following year. I know that in all the departments, I think there was an action calendar. And an action calendar would commence at the beginning of the fiscal year. End of June 30th, July 1st, here's the action calendar. And it would detail exactly what's going on here. I thought it was a very helpful tool when I was working as faculty, and I've heard from secretaries it's helpful. So that's the concept, I think, would be, here it is, that kind of thing. And again, there's an appendix that could be attached. This doesn't have to be part of the governance manual. Governance manuals can have appendices if needs be, so that can be laid out thusly. But again, it moves us into, okay, we say we're going to do it, and here's the month. It could be July. Again, I have no problem if that's the board's will. Take the revisions. We'll start in July, and then move on, just adjust things accordingly. So I don't want to speak for my other subcommittee members, but I'm more than willing to take these concerns, and if these second reading doesn't pass muster, we can make a first of something else.
Yeah. Is this something we should, is this something we should push off to the next retreat in February, add it to that agenda, or?
May I address that? I would say, again, being the writer, if you will, a little bit, I'd like to get drafts into people's hands before then, and get that feedback flowing before then, and hit it again if needs be. So that's my answer to your question, sir.
So you, again, I'm trying to get this straight with you. So if we're not sure on this, should we vote no then, and then make tweaks? Vote no, I think that's the way it's going to go. I just don't want to
those in Vermont, they want to be in there and come up. But what we're referring to here, I think what you're referring to, are planning issues. Let's make sure we do this in the coming year, like evaluation of the president. Let's make sure we do have a planning session. Let's make sure we do stipulate some priorities for the year going forward. Beyond that, I think the world around us and the issues around us are going to drive other things that we need to talk about now, or another time period comes. So we'll start with that draft. And then if you or any other trustee thinks that it would be good if we talked about X in May, for whatever reason, we can stipulate, okay, we're going to talk about that in May. Might be enrollment. Might be.
So if I understand correctly, you have a copy of something that's called, the details is action calendar.
Yeah.
This was something that you gave to Nicholas then, Sarah? Mm-hmm. And that all
well, it's something that's been in existence.
Okay.
Yeah, it has tuition on it. We do tuition
certain,
in a certain month.
We have to approve tuition in a certain month.
Right.
We have to approve the budget in a certain month.
Right. Okay.
Things like that. That's what's on the calendar.
Okay.
We use that as a template and then plug in the other months.
Understand.
These other items that I think all of us appreciate the subcommittee bringing forward.
Yeah. And this document is something that's separate from the governor's manual.
Yeah.
Correct.
What happened last year, because of the pandemic, is we put a lot of those things aside. Things happened at different times, at least that's my perspective. I haven't been on the board as long as most of you. But a lot of things were put on hold, I feel. So it appears like we weren't following the action calendar at times.
Well, if the chair wishes to keep this subcommittee going in some form, or maybe have other people join with it too, I'd be happy to continue with this calendar and take that as template and make additions as I understand them now.
Well, at this point, what I'd like to do is get the calendar and to know it in everybody's hands, and then all the trustees look at it and give an opinion on specific topics you think would be best addressed in June, October, some particular month. And we might have difference of opinions. So we'll get a draft going and circulate it, and it'll be a working document.
Yeah, I was hoping for the board to discuss what would be on that calendar.
I mean, you can talk about that in the future.
Yeah, I proposed that ideas.
But to John's point, by the time we get there, we'll already have a draft.
Would that not be a good thing?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. And it'll start with what Sarah puts in her
mouth. Who will put together the
draft? Whatever suggestions come from you or any other trustee, we'll send that draft.
She said we had a vote. I don't know what it
is. Yeah, if we want if there's specific topics that we think are best discussed in a given month, we want to plug it in.
Right.
Okay.
Yes?
Okay. Any other questions?
So do we, can it just lie, or, I mean, the motion would have to be, I make a motion that we not approve the change, right? Wouldn't that have to be the case, or Johnson's going to just lay foul on it and just don't do it?
If there is no motion.
We need a motion and support.
To approve?
Well, let me ask this, if there's no motion, what happens?
I don't know.
We just go back to a first reading.
There's something about parliamentary procedures, Senator, we have to follow so that we can't make it go away until we vote one way or another.
All right, how about this? I'll make a motion based on tonight's discussion and the discussion from our retreat to table the second reading of the edits to the governance manual until the subcommittee can reconvene and use the templated schedule and make adjustments such that we can all review it once again.
So they can edit, make changes,
correct.
Delete, add.
Yes, based on our discussion.
And
right.
It'll
they
come
have
out as
the
first. And it'll come out as the first edition.
Correct.
First
correct.
Okay, is there support for that motion?
So that's a motion to table. Correct? Yeah,
correct.
I support that.
Yes.
Any further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
page 65.
Then again, the words in blue are the additions, and where there's a line, obviously that's a deletion. We need to read that, start off the record?
No.
Okay. So that's the change in the policy 2.1. Is there a motion to approve the changes as presented?
So moved.
So moved. Is there support?
Support.
Support. Any discussion?
This is right in the spirit of other such documents and statements that I've read and seen from other universities and colleges, so it's well done, and I agree with Dr. Fritz's analysis of it here. This is something that's a good thing.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. 2.5 is basically the same changes in a different location. Is there a motion to approve those changes as presented? Is there support?
Support.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries. Now, our new business, we have board leadership. As I indicated last meeting, I have decided to step aside as chair. I'll chair the remainder of this meeting. But this time, the floor is open for nominations of persons that are able and willing serve as chair.
May I ask a question first on that? I sent you an email last night, maybe you didn't get it in that regard. We had this organizational meeting in January of 2021 where we elected chair, etc. My concept that I shared, sent to you, Nicholas, was could we do it in January again? If you finish out your term here in December, if we were to get people identified who might want to run for chair or vice chair, that would give us some time to talk to individuals, to see what the vision is, to see what the ideas are, in a more relaxed fashion rather than here and now and out. So that was my pitch to you, and I would advocate for a little time as we did it in January and do it in 2022.
My answer is no. This is my last board meeting as chair.
Well, it still would be, wouldn't it? Because in 2022, we'd be electing a new chair. So that's...
We're going to do it tonight. It's on the agenda, we're going to do it.
No.
Who would like to serve as chair?
I nominate Dr. Karen Meyer as chair.
Dr. Meyer. Any other nominations? Going once? Twice? All those in favor of confirming Dr. Niver as the incoming chair effective the January meeting, please say aye.
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 Aye. Is anybody opposed to that? No. Having the vice chair move into the chair position, do we have any nominations for vice chair starting in January? You can nominate yourself.
Marsha Robbins for vice chair.
Marsha Robbins for vice chair. Any other nominations?
Can I ask, I just want to ask, can somebody fill me in? I know I've been on the board a year. You know, John came in just after me a month later. How many years has everybody been on the board? Can I ask that question, Marsha? How many years care about?
I'm going on 6 years.
Six?
Red?
Five.
At least six.
You've been on longer than that, Bob.
Right.
Yeah, Bob.
Yeah, I was going to say
longer than that.
Because I've been on 12.
Thank you. Very good.
Okay.
Thank you. So,
I need a motion to appoint or to confirm that Marsha Robbins would serve as a vice chair effective at the January meeting.
So moved.
So moved. Is there support?
Support.
Support. All those in favor, any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Those opposed? 2022, thank you for serving.
Thank you.
I want to say I appreciate the board voting unanimously for the two candidates. Whatever the candidates were, I appreciate the board, and I hope that the board views that as a positive direction, that all of us, even though we have our differences, we unanimously support the board.
The 22 meeting schedule. Sarah, is that?
Yes, it's in your packet.
Yep.
That is done.
See it. Page 16.
Got it. So this is the second Thursday of each month, and the retreats are on the Friday following a monthly retreat. So the first retreat is February 11, May 13, August 12. There is no meeting in July. And that's that. Is there a motion to approve the 2022 meeting schedule?
So moved.
So moved. Is there support?
Support.
Support. Any discussion?
I would just like to point out, I believe at the February retreat there will be a discussion about possible skilled trades or other items out there that some other colleges may have. I don't know where to go. I just want to make a point that was brought up tonight that we are looking at other areas to identify may or not be worth having classes here or to follow.
Yeah, new program. Accreditation process. At the retreat, Dr. Snyder passed out the HLC report that was referenced earlier. And we had the chief academic officer present. Also for that meeting. And as I recall, we have until July of 23 to write the report. And the report writing is in the hands of faculty and the chief academic officers working with faculty to produce the document. And do you want anything different? That's it.
To the schedule here, is this kind of past practice to roll over the dates then, change the years basically, keep these like the Friday after the Thursday meeting and so
on? Oh, yeah, it's always on the section Thursday.
Yeah, okay.
And the retreat is always the Friday following a retreat. Now we can change that, obviously.
You know what?
Just the year, if we want to have another meeting, we can call another meeting, or we want to move a retreat.
Is there a motion?
So accreditation is.
I'm sorry, did we approve this?
Yes.
Okay, I'm sorry, I missed that. Okay.
So there's nothing more to report. The accreditation process. And I really do appreciate the faculty for standing up and providing more information about that.
I can report something if you'd like. Nope. Go ahead.
But after the meeting.
Sure.
Meeting broadcasting. I forget who brought this up. One of us brought this up. This is a concept of televising meetings.
Yes.
We've talked, it's come up, more than once. Meetings being taped. I personally welcome it. Tape. We're transparent. It's subject to the Open Meetings Act. I appreciate being taped. There's been a lot. So I don't know if this is how far it goes. We tape our meetings, whether someone from the audience is taping it or someone in the community college media department tapes it. Whether we go forward further, I'm not a media expert here. I,
concept was, Nicholas, that the idea of people rightfully concerned about COVID and meeting in groups would have access to the meetings being broadcast, Zoom link or something of that nature at home where they can click and follow along. That was the concept in play. And I know that Marysville City Council broadcast, Fort Huron broadcast, City Council. So that was the concept. Again, it can be discussed probably more in depth at the retreat to see if we have the facilities and the wherewithal and desire to do so.
Again, we don't, just so you mentioned Marysville and Fort Huron, we don't, I'll just use Marysville. Our meetings are broadcast live on Channel 6 or one of the affiliated stations. And then we just insert it the next day on our website. So if anybody wants to watch it the next day, it's uploaded. It's uploaded to the website. We do not let, it isn't where it's Zoom and this, where people can call in under public audience or something like that. It's just that it's taped live at 7:30, and then if you don't watch it, want to watch it the next day or whatever, you can go to our website, hit the button, and watch the meeting. As an example, Jim Block from the Voice newspaper. Jim used to come to our meetings as a counselor. He has not come to our meetings, as I haven't seen him in a year. But if you read the Voice, Jim writes an article on Marysville or wherever he's coming, and it's almost word for word because he goes and hits the link the next day or the next week, and he writes the article from there, even though he's not. But it's not an interaction with the people at home or anything like that. It just takes what we're doing tonight, I guess, one step further. And again, I just think it's if we want to do it, it's just something we can discuss down the road, if not tonight. That's why John or I put it on the meeting.
So we're recording this meeting, right?
Yes.
And
what are you going to post that on the website?
Are you talking to me?
Yes.
It's a possibility.
Okay. But for now, you're just recording this.
And it's audio. There's no video here.
It's audio. I asked Sarah to, prior to the meeting, not do a major survey, but call around some of the other colleges. And correct me, but some do it, some don't. Some do it and wish they didn't.
Correct.
So it's kind of all over the map. I actually ran across an article in ACCT about the pros and cons. And that would be something we could talk about too at the retreat setting. The obvious positive is the one that you indicate. Those who would like to know what's going on and can't come to the meeting and be here in person would love to have the opportunity to at least know what the board talked about, decisions that were made, etc. The cons are interesting. Kind of a study in human psychology. Some people don't do well in front of a camera. They hold back. They don't speak as openly and as freely as they would if there was no television. Some people use it as an opportunity to grandstand. They play the audience rather than playing to our fellow trustees. I've been on television a few times, and it's awkward. I find it awkward. And I do find myself choosing my words very carefully. Maybe that's just me. So there's the ones that don't do it apparently have had some negative reactions to the participants, and so they don't. Others do it, love it.
Would you send that article around that you said pros and cons?
I
must have missed that one.
Yeah. I forget the exact source, but
pulled one too. I actually did a little research for myself to try to understand better the pros and cons, and you can have this. I printed one out just for myself. This is from the trustee I think it's good to reference. After I read this, my thought would be to not
see, because, you know, we should consider what's typical in the state of Michigan. And community colleges, I looked at just random seven, I looked up when their board meetings were going to be held, and then they state whether they're going to be in public meeting. And so there, out of seven of them, five had no recording or no broadcast. One was remote because of COVID, although I wonder if that's even accurate, because as you stated, it's illegal to do that right now. I don't know if illegal is the right term, but it's against accepted practices. And then one was in person along with WebEx because of COVID limitancy. So one out of seven. And that's just random that I looked at. I didn't go any further than that at the time required.
My gut reaction is I wouldn't want to do it. That's me. But if somebody wants to, you know, listen to the audio recording, we can certainly make that available on our website.
So again, further discussion for February, I think. Just,
yeah.
You know, further discussion. All good points. Everybody can talk, and let's add it on for February.
Okay. Any other comments on that? Faculty appointment, probationary status.
So we have two full-time teachers. It's a recommendation for administration to take action to approve the following and other appointments. Probationary status effective at the beginning of 2022 semester, in engineering technology, and Keith Johnson, who is also in engineering technology.
Okay. Is there a motion to hire these two individuals for the purposes so indicated?
So moved.
So moved.
Second.
And support. Any further discussion?
Yes, I have two. I just want to point out, it looks like I always like Mr. Amy, attended SC4. I always like that. And nothing against Mr. Johnson, he went to Macomb Community College. That's good too. And then I guess, since we're ending the year, can somebody tell me how many, because we had talked about this when I first got on the board, how many new positions full time have we hired in the last year?
You know?
We hired a nursing for this fall, nursing, two English, psychology, astronomy, physics. Then these two in engineering technology. And we have two temporary full-time, one in nursing and one in geography. But as far as probationary full-time, I guess it'd be seven.
Thank
my numbers are
thank you.
Just a question too. I went and saw the engineering technology program, and it's electronics, graphics and CAD, mechatronics, precision machining, welding, and fabricating. Will these individuals be teaching all of those disciplines, or is there any knowledge about that? Just curious, that's all. I mean, there was, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
They don't teach welding.
It won't be the welding, but the other ones are probably within their. Okay, it's good to know. Thank you.
Your colleague may have information that you can share after the meeting.
Even though he's in chemistry,
he
knows all. That's right.
All right, that's it. I'm not aware of any reports. Is there a motion to adjourn?
Before we do that, Nicholas, thank you. Thank you for serving as chair. Thank you. That role is a little different than the rest of our role. So again, I know we all appreciate your efforts, and and again, Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays, Happy
Hanukkah. You're coming in hard.
Covering it off. Motion to adjourn.
Thank you. There's support. Support. All in favor, sit around saying aye.
Aye.
Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays.
Yes, it's just a window.
That's right.
There you go.
A lot better than one.
Yeah.
I know the cold that you had.
Sarah,
not from you.
He's still going to give you a cold or whatever that is.
Name.
That was the name.
But I got to say, with the doctor in my eyes, it's generally extended to the day.
Yeah.
I was almost thankful that he stepped off for you.
Yeah.
He was.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Well, that's what I wanted to hear.
It's just a copy of an email.
You know, there's a set up for a TV studio. There's a three camera set up with a regular television for like every day of the cameras all in the
Friday. No, I think it's just
we can do anything that it needs to be done at a